Good morning and welcome. It is so good to see you all this morning. We are glad you're here. However you may be joining us today, we are glad that you are here on this blessing of the backpacks and hot dog Sunday. Remember, please fill out the friendship pads if you are in the sanctuary so you may greet the folks who are worshiping with you. Also, if you're so inclined, tag yourself on Facebook as well. Thank you, everyone, who made Barefoot Sunday such a wonderful day. I don't have an official number, but between the shoes and the monetary gifts, I think your gift to Step by Step has to be over $5,000, which, you know, we are very grateful for your generosity. Thank you, everyone, who helped organize and participated in our cleanup day yesterday. We had a great group. The playground looks absolutely beautiful. We can actually see the stage in the dining room. A lot of work was done inside and out. Beloved, I can't tell you how much we depend on your help to keep our facilities in good shape. And I do very much appreciate your effort. Today, we will bless backpacks during the time for children. Then, we believe weather is permitting, so we're going to gather on the playground for Hot Dog Sunday. We hope you brought your appetite. If you get out there and you think it's a little warm, we've got the Susie Early room, we've got the Ruffner room, air conditioning's on, so you can come in and enjoy your meal in there. But we're going to gather there for hot dogs. We are grateful for everybody who has helped make today possible. You know, it's going to be a wonderful day and a nice little prelude. How do you like that, Jason? Prelude to Rally Day on September 11th. Now, September 11th is an inauspicious day to celebrate our life together. I understand that. But we bring hope to people even when life seems hopeless. That's our calling as Christians. So we have much for which to give thanks on that day, even such an inauspicious day. We're planning for a great meal after church. Chicken. No, not Presbyterian chicken. That's an indoor dish. That's an indoor dish. But it will be good chicken. And since we're Presbyterian, it be kind of Presbyterian chicken. But no, we'll have that one day. Great meal after church. If Mother Nature cooperates, we're going to do a butterfly release after worship. Now, you got to understand, those butterflies might come a week before. They may stay in the cocoon for a week after. And so if they're not ready on September 11th, I apologize in advance, but we're going to try to do a butterfly release on September 11th. We're going to have some games for the children. If some of you want to help organize some games for adults, like musical chairs or a cakewalk or even a pie-eating contest, let us know. We can put you in contact with the right people. We'd love to have some of those old-time games. Regardless, mark your calendar and bring your friends. Our flood relief efforts continue. We've added some local needs. What and where to donate are in the green sheet. Thank you, everyone who's supported our efforts these past few weeks. We've got some new things to tell you about. Yeah, it's that time of year. I apologize. Wednesday, September 14th, Logos begins. I hope you saw the sign from the 1970s out there. No, it's a beautiful sign. It'll catch your attention. But Logos begins in earnest on Wednesday, the 14th. On Thursday, the 15th, a time for refreshment begins. We'll be here on Thursday afternoons for tea and shortbread or cookies and conversation. Just stop by when you feel like it. We have a new member in choirs class coming up on worship on September 18th. We'll be serving lunch for that, so we need you to call the church office. Please call If you just tell the pastor that you're planning to attend, chances are you're going to go hungry that day. We want food for everybody. So call Diana at the church office, and she will make sure that we have food enough for all. Please note our financial update in the green sheet. Beloved, there's a lot to unpack there. We don't have time. We can talk about all that at a time for refreshment. But let me say this. Yes, if we were fully staffed, our budget would be much tighter. We know that. We appreciate your continued support, even though we're running such a large surplus. Your generous support has allowed us to create a capital contingency fund, so we don't have to undermine our budget or our investments if we have a crisis that arises. It's allowed us to address much-needed safety issues on a timely manner. We haven't had to put things off. In fact, we're going to have people inspecting the outside of the building, I think, this week. We were able to forego taking the third quarter draw to give our invested funds time to recover. So even though we do have this surplus, your generosity was appreciated because it helped us to find a stronger financial position and take some things, get some things done that we needed to. We've said goodbye to John Petrie, our facilities manager. Halliburton made an offer he couldn't refuse, and he will be deeply missed by many of us. The good news, as I alluded to, tomorrow we welcome Diana Voorhees as our office administrator. Many of you know Diana. I'm not sure we've hired anyone that has drawn such excitement as a new hire to this church. So we are grateful that Diana is joining us and look forward to having her as part of our staff. Beloved, God is good.
All the time.
All the time. Let us prepare our hearts to worship.
Please join in our call to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. With what shall we come before the Holy One and bow ourselves before God on high? What does the Holy One require of us but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with our God?
Thank you.
Jason, we may sing this one every week. Amen. Beloved, when we gather to worship God, we remember we are God's people and realize we have often preferred our own way instead of God's. Trusting God's promise to create anew, let us confess our sin before God and each other. O God of mercy, we confess that we live self-centered lives. We are your children, but we turn from your wisdom and walk in our own ways. We live carelessly and squander time. We are foolish and fail to understand your will. You offer the joy of your Spirit, yet we waste away in sin and grief. You offer the life of your word, yet we turn away in doubt and despair. Forgive us, God of grace. By the power of your Spirit, make us more tender and kind, living as your beloved children, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Beloved, if God is for us, who is against us? In Jesus Christ, you are set free. Know you are forgiven and be at peace. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Let us greet one another with the sign of our reconciliation in Christ Jesus.
Our first reading is from Isaiah, and our second reading is from Psalms. If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom be like the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places and make your bones strong, and you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters never fall. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live in. If you refrain from trampling the Sabbath, from pursuing your own interests on my holy day, if you call the Sabbath a delight and the holy day of the Lord honorable, if you honor it, not going your own ways, serving your own interests, or pursuing your own affairs, then you shall take delight in the Lord, and I will make you ride upon the heights of the earth. I will feed you with the heritage of your ancestor Jacob, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works vindication and justice for all those who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. Our gospel reading this morning is from the Gospel of Luke. Now Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. And just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and was quite unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, and not on the Sabbath day." But the Lord answered him and said, "You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day?" When Jesus said this, all his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing. The word of the Lord. At this time, I would invite our children and our youth and anyone who is planning to have a backpack blessed to come forward.
Let's have teachers come down too, and Sunday school teachers, and children's church teachers. How's that? And did you bring your backpack? If you didn't, that's okay. If you didn't bring your backpack, I still want you to come down. And you know what? I want you to put your backpacks on. Go ahead and put your backpack on, Landon. Put it on your back and wear it on your back. And if we need more room, we've got some room over here and some room over there. I have my backpack, but it looks a little different, and it's super heavy. So, no, I like it. It's okay. All right. Oh, it's so nice to see all of you. And even if you didn't bring a backpack, you can still get a blessing, because it's not really for your backpacks, is it? It's really for you. Do you know what a blessing is? Anybody raise your hand if you know what a blessing is. Yes, ma'am. Kylie?
I don't really know.
You don't want to do it? Okay. Anybody else know what a blessing is?
Me.
Yes, what's a blessing?
Saying
thank you, God? Is that what it? Yeah, okay. Well, a blessing is something you receive, and we are going to receive a blessing from God and our church family. Now, the blessing that we're going to receive is saying that we hope that God takes care of you, protects you, guides you, and loves you when you're at school and all the time. But especially today, we're talking about when you're at school. So, anybody know who's our church family? Yes? Who's our church family? Can you point to one? Yes, right there is some church family. Who's our church family? Me? Okay. Maybe like one more? Everybody that's sitting out here in our congregation? Exactly. We're going to ask them to help bless our backpacks. So I would like everybody to go and stand by one of those ribbons that are kind of yellow or red or something. Stand by one of those, just the kids. So go stand by one of those And there's some down this aisle, and if you don't have a backpack, it's okay. Yep, and there's some over there too. There's some places over there to stand. Why don't you guys go that way? And there's some over here. Everybody stand, and you know what? If there's nobody standing, if there's nobody sitting by the ribbon, you need to actually be near somebody, a person. So go over there. See, there's one. Go up there. Go this way. And then I want you to turn around. Turn around so your backpack faces them, okay? And they're not going to touch you, but they're going to put, as many people as can, are going to put their hands on the backpacks, okay? Are we okay in the back there, finding more people? You can let anybody. You don't have to be next to a ribbon, okay? does everybody have somebody to touch their backpack? All right. So we're going to do a blessing of the backpacks. Grown-ups, you can get up and move so that you can touch somebody's backpack too. Let me see here if I can help you. There, we need one right here. We need one, two right here. Here's one right here. Right here. Logistics are very fun, aren't they? Stand right there for just a second. Okay, when you're all done, I want you to come back and we're gonna give you a backpack tag that has some more blessings on it. And it also has scripture on the back that might help you if you're feeling kind of upset at school or wondering what you should be doing. And so, and it also has our church phone number in case you want to talk to somebody. Maybe you don't feel like talking to mom or dad or your teacher, but you want to talk to somebody about a problem at school, you can call the church and we'll help you too. Okay, grown-ups, do you have your insert? Do you have your insert? Okay. Let us pray and bow our heads and receive the blessing of the backpacks and the children. Responsively.
Dear God of fresh starts and new beginnings, we bring ourselves, our big feelings, and our backpacks to you.
Loving God, hold our children in your care.
In our backpacks, we carry pencils, pointy crayons, paper, all kinds of things. And in our hearts, we carry big feelings, lots of questions, and hope for a great year.
Loving God, hold our children in your care.
There are endless possibilities of what this new year might bring, of what we might learn, and who we might become.
Loving God, hold our children in your care.
Be with them as they ride the bus or walk or get dropped off at the door. Be with them as they buckle seat belts, zip up jackets, and tie shoes. Bless this journey into something new.
Loving God, hold our children in your care.
For the grown-ups going back to school, be with them too. Thank you for our teachers, helpers, caregivers, leaders, and parents, and for all they do to help us learn and grow.
Loving God, hold our children in your care.
God, our friend who is full of wonder, fill their hearts and bless their hands.
Loving God, hold our children in your care.
Amen.
Amen. All right, children, come back down here and grown-ups, as we do this, I'd like you to sing Jesus Loves Me to the children. And that they'll be dismissed from here on out. So.
Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Margie. Like most older siblings, when Elizabeth was a child, they'd at times become angry if their younger brother Will even thought about touching their stuff. Our preemptive invitation was often a gentle reminder. Elizabeth, remember, people are more important than things. It's been a while since we've had to offer this reminder to Elizabeth. They're now 30 years old. They live in a studio apartment and work with the Northwest Justice Project in Seattle. NJP offers free legal assistance addressing fundamental human needs, including housing, family safety, income security, health care, education, and more. Their work enhances the well-being of low-income persons, families, and communities by challenging systemic and racial inequities. I'm not sure how much our gentle reminders influenced Elizabeth, but they clearly embraced our expectation that they would see people as more important than things somewhere along the way. Expectations shape our lives. Whether coming from parents, friends, co-workers, or ourselves, whether social, cultural, interpersonal, professional, political, or religious, whether we embrace them or reject them, expectations shape our lives. But they can also consume us. A little over 20 years ago, I read a column in the Sunday edition of the Press Citizen in Iowa City, Iowa, written by Tom Simmons. Though his numbers may need to be adjusted for inflation, his observations remain timely. Mr. Simmons shared his experience of going bankrupt as a consequence of divorce and too many years of attempting to live on one income in a two-income society. He wasn't alone. That year, almost 3,500 Iowans declared bankruptcy. Mr. Simmons shared the challenges of living up to the expectations of the Iowa City lifestyle, from the parties we throw our children to the cars we drive to get them to soccer, baseball, hockey, gymnastics, piano, and dance, from the cost of our computers and cell phones and the money it takes to stay connected at the fastest speeds possible, from the high cost of having the right shoes and clothes. Most folks couldn't live up to these cultural expectations, and many went broke trying. He didn't even mention the cost of a social life. In those days, $50 was a cheap date, dinner, movie, babysitter. God knows what most folks were spending on a Hawkeye football weekend or an evening of theater. Now, Mr. Simmons wasn't being critical of the culture. He appreciated the cultural opportunities and the quality of life they offered. His concern was with how easily cultural expectations consume us. A trip to Walmart with his 9-year-old daughter, Georgia, led Mr. Simmons to reflect more deeply on many of the cultural expectations we so often take for granted. Instead of begging for an expensive toy, she asked for chalk. She then spent the afternoon drawing. And he wonders, what must it have been like before home computers and video games and Planet X and SUVs and home video systems and credit cards and the emphasis on more, more, more? What must it have been like when the only thing you could do was draw or play ball or read or go outside? Mr. Simmons ends his column in a remarkable place. He lets go of the cultural expectations that led him into bankruptcy to embrace a different set, what I would call a more godly set of expectations. Meanwhile, my small number of monthly dollars will go toward chalk, markers, the oldest car I can keep running, and the dearest children in the world. To make this change is easier said than done. Margie and I made a conscious choice to raise our children differently. They didn't have a TV in their room. They didn't have cell phones until they were in high school. They watched public television and Disney. They had strict bedtimes and curfews. Though they were active in extracurriculars, worship came first over everything else. They weren't raised like many of their friends. And that was hard at times. Beloved, our children weren't perfect. We made mistakes. They weren't better than their friends. It's unfair to compare our children to anybody. But they became better versions of themselves. Church relationships made them better versions of themselves. We made our expectations clear about life and about church, and for the most part, they embraced them. God's people are confused. Returning from 50 years of exile in Babylon, they've forgotten who they are. They desire to draw near to God. They fast, they clothe themselves in sackcloth and ashes, they humble themselves, they pray, they do everything they thought they were supposed to do to get close to God. Nothing. God doesn't notice, God doesn't respond. No matter what they do, God doesn't seem to care. Why does God not hear their cries? Why does God not answer their prayers? They don't love their neighbors. They're religious, but religion isn't a substitute for love. Without love, our worship is a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. Love is shown through acts of compassion and justice toward others, especially people in need. The God to whom we pray expects us to challenge the evil in our lives and our world with love. The God to whom we pray expects us to question the powers and principalities that consume our souls and our relationships with love. The God to whom we pray expects us to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. The God to whom we pray condemns bitterness, strife, and false witness. The God to whom we pray demands an end to racial injustice and other forms of oppression. The God to whom we pray expects us to feed people who are hungry, clothe people who are naked, shelter people who are homeless, and comfort people who grieve. The God to whom we pray expects us to love our neighbors. If we want God to hear our prayers, we must consider how we live. Are we living up to God's expectations? Probably not. We're human. If we desire to be close to God, if our worship is sincere, we will consider how we live and repent where we need to repent. Being religious, singing the hymns, saying our prayers, even confessing our sins are helpful, but not enough. Living the faith we profess, standing in the gap, repairing the breach, reweaving the social fabric, restoring relationships, these are the things God expects from us. Living Monday, the faith we profess on Sunday. Loving God with all that we are. Loving our neighbors, especially the ones we don't like very much. This is how we embrace God's expectations. Is this not the fast God chooses? To loose the bonds of injustice, to let the oppressed go free. Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them and not to hide yourself from your own kin. If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom shall be like the noonday. Beloved, we are God's children. Every day we are confronted by a legion of expectations, claiming our lives and seeking our loyalty. We must choose wisely, or we'll be consumed. Only embracing God's expectations will bring us life and joy. You've heard me mention the one-room intergenerational Sunday school class we're starting this fall. We'll sing some Sunday school songs. We'll dramatize a Bible story. We'll do a craft, maybe have some juice and cookies. Pastor Myers, the 1950s, called. They want their Sunday school back. Yeah, I think that's what we did when I was in Sunday school. Of course, we didn't have all your costumes. Have you seen the fourth floor? I get it. People who are supposed to know how to nurture our children's faith have been telling us for decades, we need a costly curriculum. We need catchy videos. We need pyrotechnics if we're going to attract children. Maybe they're right. Perhaps we do need all that stuff to attract children and youth. But I'm not here to attract children, youth, young families, or adults. I can't worry about people who choose not to be here. I can only care for the people who are here. Does this mean we don't want new people? Of course not. There's always room for more. Look around. I'd love to have a large new member class in September. But what I'm saying is, it doesn't matter if we have 3 or 30. I'm going to be grateful they've chosen to share in our life together. It's not about numbers. It's about relationships. Nurture the relationships and the numbers will follow. Do you want your children and grandchildren and neighbor children to be better versions of themselves? Bring them to Sunday school and church regularly. Don't have any children? Come and nurture ours. They're beautiful. Beloved, the expectations placed upon our children, even the youngest ones, each and every day, are legion. We can give them the faith and the relationships to have life and joy. We can give them the faith and the relationships to embrace God's expectations and choose wisely. But we have to teach them by our example. And we can only teach them when we're all here together. Thanks be to God.
The life, death, resurrection, and promised coming of Jesus Christ has set the pattern for the church's mission. His life involves the church to work in the common life of humanity. His service to all people commits the church to work for every kind of need. His crucifixion discloses to the church God's judgment on our inhumanity to one another and the awful consequences of our own complicity in injustice. In the power of the risen Christ and the hope of his coming, the church sees the promise of God's renewal of each person's life and society, and of God's victory over all wrong. The church follows this pattern in the form of its life and in the method of its action. So to live and serve is to confess Christ as Lord.
Beloved, as we prepare to offer our lives to God, we continue our prayers for the people of Ukraine enduring this season of war, as well as immigrants and refugees around the world, many who've come from such war-torn countries. As we mark the anniversary of the Taliban takeover, we pray for women in Afghanistan and around the world, especially those who are enduring hardship and violence because of their gender. We pray as well for those enduring famine in Afghanistan and so many places around the world. We continue our prayers for so many of our neighbors as they continue their cleanup after severe flooding, wildfires, and storms. And we give thanks for all participating in the relief and cleanup efforts. Grateful for such a wonderful preschool open house on Friday and the return of our children, we give thanks for teachers and administrators who provide for the care and nurture of our children. As schools open around the nation and Sunday school begins, we pray for teachers and administrators, superintendents, parents, and students, coaches, and advisors, that they may have a safe and productive year. We pray especially for school librarians having to face the challenge of radical ignorance when intimidation and violence are used to silence free thought and speech. We continue to pray for our congregation as we prepare for an exciting fall. We pray for all who've been recently hospitalized or are under a doctor's care, especially the Owen and Connolly families, as well as Bob Newman. We pray also for the family and friends of Lester Davis. We give thanks for the good work being done by all those with whom we serve to bring hope to the people of Charleston and beyond, especially Step by Step, who had one of their sites broken into this week. Beloved, let us enter into a spirit of prayer. The Lord be with you. Everlasting God, in whom we live and move and have our being, you have made us for yourself so that our hearts are restless until they rest in you. Give us purity of heart and strength of purpose that no selfish passion may hinder us from knowing your will, no weakness keep us from doing it. That in your light we may see light clearly and in your service find perfect freedom. God of compassion, we praise you that you look upon our frail lives with love and understanding, and that you desire for us all new life in Jesus Christ. We are overwhelmed by your love, which goes to the cross for us, endures the grave, and leads us to new life. By your Spirit, strengthen our souls to be brave and bold in Christ's service. Take our lives and our love and use them for your purposes. Give us zealous hearts alive with love for you and shared with all who are longing to know your love. Hear now the prayers upon our minds and hearts this day. We offer these and all of our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Savior and Lord, praying as he teaches us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
Beloved, God, the source of all good things, has given us what we need. In joyful response, let us offer our gifts, the fruit of our labors, and the dedication of our lives for loving service in the name of Jesus Christ. God of abundant grace and boundless love, we come before you today with all that we are and with all that we have, so that we may bear witness to your love in the world. Transform our souls and bodies by your grace, so we may be free to proclaim the gospel of justice and peace. Do wondrous things with the gifts we bring, and strengthen us to bring new life to all whose lives we touch, as we await the return of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. I will go outside to greet folks who might go out that way, but I hope I'm very lonely, because I want you to enjoy the best hot dogs West Virginia has to offer. I've even heard through the grapevine I may have a taker on the hot dog eating contest. Don't let that dissuade you. Beloved, lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. And as you go, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all this day and forevermore. Amen.